This Civic Media podcast is sponsored by UW Organ and Tissue Donation. Organ donations are desperately needed, and now is the right time to become an organ donor. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. Go to heroicdeed.com.
Live from the Civic Media World Headquarters in Madison, Wisconsin, it's the Todd Albaugh Show. And now, pursuing truth wherever it may lead, here's your host, Todd Albaugh.
Across Wisconsin on the Civic Media Radio Network and streaming worldwide on the Civic Media app. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Todd Albaugh, along with Mr. Aaron Zommer is on the board, 6 past the hour of 1 o'clock on this TGIF Friday edition, October 25th. It is a great day to be a Wisconsinite. Welcome in. Beautiful sunny skies for a homecoming weekend here for University of Wisconsin-Madison Badgers. Big homecoming parade this afternoon. I hope to get down to it. Always a lot of fun. Huge crowds. I love it. Wisconsin marching band comes through. All kinds of different student orgs throwing out gifts. Families bring down the kids because you got Bucky Badger there and the band and actual real floats, which I always appreciate. The fraternities and sororities go to a lot of work. The student orgs, real floats, the different sports teams come through. A good time had by all.
When is this happening?
This afternoon. I think around 4:35, something like that. By the way, if you're thinking about driving in downtown Madison this afternoon, don't.
Just not the move.
It's not. I mean, come down now if you can, or come down, get here by, you know, 4:30, get yourself a parking spot and walk onto campus. But then don't plan on going anywhere till about 8 o'clock because traffic does get nuts. But it's a great time, you understand. It's a lot of fun. And then, of course, tomorrow night, the big homecoming football game against Penn State, beat Penn State 6:30 on NBC or the Peacock, but better yet, right here on Civic Media on the Wisconsin Badger Radio Network, Matt LePay, Mark Tauscher, and the entire crew. Pre-game probably start around 4:35, and then the game at around 6, kickoff around 6:30 on the Badger Radio Network. So, and you can download the Civic Media app, and you can listen to LePay and Tauscher for free. Anywhere you got internet or cell phone service.
Which, by the way, there's actually another event today that I almost forgot to bring up.
What's that?
My roommate, Elliot, it is his birthday.
Really?
Welcome to the Quarter Century Club, Elliot.
Well, Elliot, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Elliot, very good. A longtime listener. We appreciate him. So shout out to Elliot on his birthday. It's funny you mentioned birthdays, Mr. Zommers. Did you know that today, Friday, October 25th, we observe another birthday of note. This individual was born in Japan. This movie star has gained global renown, starring in 38 feature films plus TV, video games, and an action figure. But this is no ordinary take the money and run celebrity. Oh no, today we celebrate an icon with a lifelong mission to spread a serious message to the world. It's a warning, really. First, a warning about the dangers that nuclear weapons pose to mankind. The danger was real in those early years of the 1950s, and the danger is with us still today. In more recent decades, this star has been warning us about the very survival depending on taking better care of our planet. The 70th birthday of which I speak is that of Godzilla. That's right.
Really?
Godzilla. In Japan, I did not know this. In Japan, where the first Godzilla movie was released, October 27th, 1954, there was and always has been a serious message behind the character's movie. Now, unfortunately, in America, the early movies were severely edited.
Yeah.
And the scripts were not just dubbed into English, but also rewritten.
I was going to bring that up.
Yeah. Incredible. Which had been a monster with a serious message about the environmental consequences of human actions, was dumbed down to a grab-your-date drive-in movie. In more recent years, Godzilla movies here and globally have restored some of the sincere messaging that makes Godzilla one of the planet's most enduring franchises. So here, a birthday when we can really mean it, when we say, may the next 70 years be even better than the first 70 years. Happy birthday to Godzilla today. How about that? Where, I mean, this doesn't King Kong get to sing him like a birthday wish or anything like that? I don't know.
Probably some kind of birthday brawl.
Probably. Ham, listening up in Appleton on WGBW in Green Bay, says Godzilla is one of those IPs, intellectual properties like Mickey Mouse, where you could get seriously sued if you use or allude to it. I did not know that. Well, we're not trying to steal the IP. We're right. Just mentioning it. Yeah.
But we're just saying it's a notable day for Godzilla.
Absolutely. Appreciate that insight, Ham. All right. 11 past the hour of 1 o'clock. Luke Mathers on his way in about 20 minutes or so. But right now, time once again for What's Worse. Let's go.
The choice is yours. You can get with this, or you can get with that. You can get with this, or you can get with that. You can get with this.
Time once again for What's Worse. No prize money involved. Nothing to give away. Simply your chance to have your opinion heard across statewide radio and around the world on the Civic Media app. Interesting question today from the folks in the home office. What's worse, hand-patted or pre-shaped hamburgers? What's worse, hand-patted or pre-shaped hamburgers? 855-752-4842, 855-752-4842. What's worse, hand-patted or pre-shaped hamburgers? It's been a long time since I was hand-patted. I have no idea what that even means. Hand-patted or pre-shaped hamburgers? 855-752-4842. 855-752-4842. You can also text us on the Civic Media app. You can download it for free on your Apple or Android device. What's worse, hand-patted or pre-shaped hamburgers? 855-752-4842. 855-752-4842. Now, this is a serious question, Zobbers, because some people are very hand-patted, of course, means that you have your big thing of ground beef, and then you make usually little balls, and then you kind of, pat it out. You pat it out. Or some people do the smash burger where you put that ball on the griddle, and then you push it down.
That's what I do, because I also mix in other things. It's not just beef.
Oh.
Like, it's... When I described the way I was making burgers to my mom, she was like, oh, so you're just making meatloaf chunks. And I was like, I don't want to think about it that way, but you're not wrong.
But then, of course, you have your pre-stamped round, perfectly round, pre-shaped, usually round, hamburgers. Some of them are square, I guess, if you go to Wendy's. What do you think? What's worse, a hand-patted or a pre-shaped hamburger? 855-752-4842. Let's go to Cindy in Appleton in the Fox Valley, listening on WISS. Cindy, what's worse?
Toss up. Because if I'm in a place like, McDonald's, which I don't do very often, I'd rather have fewer people touching my food.
Right?
If I'm at home, there's no other way to do it than to make it, press it myself.
Right. I think that's a great point. You hope that in places, if they're really shaping the burgers by hand, that, people have either effectively washed their hands or have a glove on or whatnot. But I mean, some of these places, they come pre-done already, right? I mean, at Culver's, it's fresh, never frozen, and they do kind of the smash burger thing where they do it right there on the spot. And then other fast food places like McDonald's, and boy, howdy, you don't want to be going there. Unless you want the old E. coli right now. But all their stuff comes, pre-shaped. So, good question.
I think it really depends what you're doing. I agree with Cindy, where if I'm making burgers for myself and some friends, I'll shape them on my own. But if you're like running a brat fry, just buy packs of burgers.
Right. Because that's true too, yeah.
Sanitary reasons, and it's going to take too long for not much of a benefit when you're just selling them.
Now, when I used to be a general manager of the Tilted Kilt, I mean, you can say what you want about the place, but the food was spectacular. And what we would get at the Tilted Kilt is, I think it was 80-20 mix. So it was pretty lean. And we would get it like in a great big log. And then we would, and our chefs, I'm pretty sure, wore gloves, and you would weigh out the amount of burger, ground beef, on a scale, so they're all uniform. And then we had a burger press. So they were pretty round, but they were done by hand. And it was, like Culver's, it was fresh, never frozen burger.
That makes a lot of sense for a restaurant.
Yeah. So they were, because you want, you know, for food cost reasons, you want it all to be the same amount of hamburger. And then also just for, you don't want somebody to get a lot more food than another person. But no, that was great food at the old Tilt and Kilt. What's worse, hand-patted or pre-shaped hamburgers? 855-752-4842. 855-752-4842. Michaela from West Bend, listening on WAUK, says pre-shaped burgers are worse. How about that?
I think Ham and Appleton has the right idea. Ham says, quote, I chew mine raw first, kind of like how you make relish, then compact it onto a metal sheet that's Norwegian made. Then I put it into my HP DeskJet printer. It happens to cut them out into the perfect circle. Just need to make sure I use the July 2009 drivers.
He's being a ham up there at Appleton.
Yeah.
All right. Dave in New Berlin, listening in, says they're the same, Todd, because the shape of the burger is in your mind when you're making it. Oh, that's interesting. A psychological take on burger making. I think, generally speaking, I think I prefer a hand patted and also a hand patted hamburger. No, I like the hand patted because it's usually fresher or more fresh. Fresher, I guess. But that said, and I'm trying to think, somebody listening, help me out. Call or text in, especially if you're in South Central Wisconsin. At Westtown Mall, years ago, there was a steak place. Was it King Arthur's? No, that's it had like a an old Camelot or whatever theme. And the burgers there were like ground steak. And they were pre-shaped, but they were so fantastically good. And I'd either get that or a ribeye steak. It was almost like a fast food steak joint because you went through like a line and then you got a tray and you got like, it was a little bit of a buffet, but not really. And then they would bring your meat out to you, your steak or whatever. I ordered like a ground round hamburger. What was the name of that place? It wasn't Arthur's. It wasn't, it was way before your time, Zomers.
Yeah, I have no idea.
If you're listening and you remember the steak place at Westtown Mall, I can't. It wasn't the ground round. It wasn't Ponderosa. I'll figure it out. I'll figure it out and come on back. And what's worse, hand patted or pre-shaped hamburgers? 855-752-4842. Luke Mathers coming up in a little bit, talking some sports. It's the All Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network.
You're listening to Civic Media. Stay up to date on the latest news and information for your local community and Wisconsin by signing up for our free email newsletter. Visit civicmedia.us/email to get started.
Welcome back to the Tell 'Em All Show on the Civic Media Radio Network, 21 past the hour of 1 on a TGIF edition on the Civic Media Radio Network, Todd Allball Show. It's Friday night. A good night to go out for fish for a lot of people. Friday night football. A UW homecoming parade if you're in Madison tonight or out for steak. Playing an edition of What's Worse, asking you, what's worse, hand-patted or pre-shaped hamburgers? And talking about one of my favorite, by and large, I'm a hand-patted kind of guy, but the best pre-shaped burger I've probably ever had was at a steakhouse in Westtown Mall. And I thought of it over the break. Lots of guesses here, and we appreciate that. On WMDX Steak Escape? No. There's one there now. That's more of the thin, almost like a steak sandwich type of deal. They're very good. And then what else up above here? Oh, Mr. Steak? Nope. Big Steer. So Mr. Steak came from Troy in Mount Horeb. Nope. Ann in Chippewa Falls listening, saying Big Steer. Nope. But we have a winner I thought of it, and then Megan within the company here let us know, and also Jim listening in Madison on WMDX. York Steakhouse. York. Very good. York Steakhouse. I think they had it. Here on WMDX, somebody said York Steakhouse was at Easttown Mall. Just as you came into the main entrance, West could have had the same. Yes, they did. In fact, York Steakhouse at Westtown Mall, for our Madison area listeners, is in the same place that Cheesecake Factory is today.
Oh.
Yep. I dialed it up here on the old interwebs. It says York Steakhouse. Oh, somebody's calling me from La Crosse, Wisconsin. Should I answer on the show?
Probably not.
Probably not, Summer says. It could be a lot of fun. Hey, you're on the air. All right, I won't answer. York Steakhouse, according to Wikipedia, was a national chain of steakhouse restaurants in the United States. It was among several chains owned by the time by cereal maker, manufacturer, I did not know this, General Mills.
I didn't either.
By 1982, there were nearly 200 restaurants in 27 states. Though popular in the late 70s and early 80s, just about my time, the majority of its locations shut down in 1989. The fate of the rest of the chain lasted until 1989, or the fate remains unclear. One source reported that the remaining York Steakhouse chain was eventually purchased by Uno Restaurant Holdings Corporation, while other sources report that the remaining steakhouse chain was sold in 89. Now, there's one, apparently, that was still in operation. The last known one was in Columbus, Ohio, as recently as 2017, a York Steakhouse. It was great.
I bet it was. But now it's gone.
Says the restaurants were run cafeteria style with a large a la carte pricing items. Tipping was not allowed at any of the restaurants. There was an extra charge for pats of butter and sour cream. Troy Mahorp says, Zomers, you're a killjoy.
At times. Tony comments on YouTube, is Trygve coming in? He loves Katy Perry because I played TGIF by Katy Perry as the intro music. You know why I did that, though?
Why?
Because it's her birthday. She turns 40 today.
Today is Katy Perry and Godzilla have the same birthday.
Katy Perry's 40, Godzilla's 70.
You know? Right. But the same day. Well, that's fantastic. Oh, no. Speaking of, we should talk about this for a minute. Trygve is not here today. However, he will be with us on Monday. I won't go into all the bloody gory details.
It's a lot.
You don't need my... Yeah, I wouldn't give my problems to a monkey on a rock, to quote David Letterman. It's been quite a week, but I can report to you this, that transportation has been secured thanks to the union, which is the group we're going to be going with next week. And it's going to be myself, along with our friend Trygve Olson, senior advisor at the Lincoln Project, and Reed Galen. Former Republican operative, was one of the co-founders of the Lincoln Project, and now he is running president of the union. The union is a subsidiary, a spinoff of the Lincoln Project. Lincoln Project is focused on defeating Trump and Trumpism. The union is focused more on voter registration and get out the vote efforts and saving democracy. They're kind of one and the same, but they're slightly different focuses. So Reed Galen will be with us, along with Trygve Olson and myself, doing a tour. 6 cities in 6 days. So we start out Monday here in Madison, Wisconsin. And then Tuesday, we're going to go up and do the show in beautiful Viroqua, Wisconsin, in southwest Wisconsin. And then we're going up to La Crosse to do... So what's going to happen is we're going to do the show in one city. Then we drive to the next, to another location where we're going to have a meet and greet. Again, invite you to come out and have a beer, some cheese curds with us. We'll buy the first drink, whether it's a beer or a soda, whatever. Order cheese curds. The rest is on you, but we'll buy the first drink and some cheese curds. And just say hi and talk civilly about politics and about the Packers or whatever else you want to talk about. So Monday, both the show and the event is here in Madison. On Monday night, we're going to be at the Inn of the Park, the old haunts and stomping grounds of the late, great Mike Ellis. We'll be sitting at the Michael G. Ellis table at the Inn of the Park. So stop on by and say hi to us on Monday night. Then Tuesday, we're doing the show in Viroqua with an event in La Crosse. Then Wednesday, we're doing the show in beautiful Osseo, Wisconsin, home of the Norsky Nook pie and restaurant place. Then doing an event in Eau Claire that evening. And then on Thursday, we're going to do the show in Wisconsin Rapids. I think we're going to be in the parking lot of our station up there, WFHR. So that'll be a lot of fun. Then doing an event in Stevens Point. Then doing the show on Friday from Appleton with an event in Green Bay. Saturday, and this has not been nailed down yet, but I think we're doing a special one-hour show on Saturday from either Green Bay or Sturgeon Bay. Then we're going to take a day to go meet folks and say hello at the Packer game. And then back in Madison on Monday to do the show at our election headquarters, which is being built as we speak right below us.
Is that it?
That's it. And then, of course, we'll be here on Tuesday for the big election. So we're going out to meet people, going out to say hi, going out to excite people about this election, get them ready to vote, have some cheese curds, have some beer or a soda, and talk about, once again, it's being called the What Makes Wisconsin Great Tour. Keep it simple. Keep it consistent. We spent all year touring the state. And many thanks to Civic Media for allowing us to do that. And we've listened to all of you. We've told your stories about people, about businesses. That's what makes Wisconsin great. We're going to celebrate it all next week and getting out the vote. And also our very special guest each and every night, Katy Perry, doing a special show at All Those Stops. No, not really. Wouldn't that be something? Back with Luke Mathers after this on the Civic Media Radio Network.
You're an organ donor, right? Well, here's a tragic fact. Approximately 20 people die each day waiting for precious donated organs. You could make a life-saving decision simply by getting that important dot on your driver's license. That little dot shows those who need to know that you've made a decision to donate organs at a critical time. Go to heroicdeed.com to learn more about the importance of organ donation and how you can make your wishes known. Talk to your family. Get the dot. Save lives. HeroicDeed.com.
Yes! Yes, Lukester! Jump! Jump! Welcome back to the Todd Hallball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. It is homecoming weekend here at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Luke Mathers, alma mater, kickoff tomorrow night around 6:30. Penn State in town, big primetime game on NBC and the Peacock. And better yet, on the Wisconsin Badger Radio Network can be heard free and live across the Civic Media Radio Network and on the Civic Media app. And an alum, a Badger.
Yes.
And here's what I'm going to start right off with it. Here's what's grinding my gears. Oh, I would have given my left arm to go to University of Wisconsin-Madison, but I didn't have the grades. And I'm in my red and white. I'm a true blue. And Luke, who studied hard and earned a way into Madison and graduated and is an alum, he ain't got any red and white on. What's going on, Luke?
That's tomorrow. If I wore that today, then I wouldn't have it tomorrow. No, I was running out of the house and I was like, it's a little chillier than just t-shirt weather. So I needed a little polar fleece kind of, or windbreaker kind of thing. That's why I got my Packer windbreaker on.
Luke Mathers, Civic Media Zone, joined us for a Tuesday Tangents with Lukester. You are in
on a
your
Friday edition.
A Friday edition of the Tuesday Tangents with Luke. Because, well, I appreciate it because our friend Kira Saban was a little ill. She's going to join us next week. Brady Ewing had stuff going on, and then you so kindly said, "Well, I could stop by." And I said,
"I was like, we got to amp up, the positivity. You were feeling a little down, and so I was like, we got to be positive." And now you're jumping around, which is great because I was concerned that you didn't like the song too much after last year when you went and heard the new sound system, and all I heard was it was too loud.
Well, it was.
Camp Randall's too loud now for you.
It was just ridiculous is what it was. It wasn't just loud. It was ridiculous. And now they've toned it down to a reasonable. Now it's fine. Everything's fine.
Okay.
You're in your Green Bay Packers windbreaker because Packers, a big game down at Jacksonville.
Yeah, big game. Hopefully not. They're like 1-5 Jacksonville.
With the way the NFC North is going, you can't lose a game.
Right, and I think Minnesota learned that the hard way last night. Yes. Sorry for that. It was a face mask penalty that was missed in the end zone, but for that safety, But I'm not going to complain too hard about it. No, unfortunate for those Vikings fans, but, you know, sometimes that's just how it goes.
By the
is
way,
it convenient that the Rams were beat by the Packers a couple weeks ago? Yeah, that will be convenient towards the end of the season. We'll see.
Yeah.
Quick thing. I always have this ready just in case it comes up, and it never has until now.
Yes.
I have Todd's impression of the sound system from last year.
Do you really?
Yes.
Oh, God. Quiet. And then and all of a sudden it was, you know, get up! Get up!
That was absolutely the Todd clip that I was referencing. I'm glad to see that he had the positivity. So that's awesome that you have that one in the sound library, Zommers.
I did not know that existed.
A well prepared producer right
there.
Hats off, Mr. Zommers.
Right?
Prepared for very specific scenarios.
And it finally happened.
It finally happened. Homecoming weekend here. Right. It's going to be interesting. Penn State under the lights of Camp Randall tomorrow night. Yeah. I'm excited to see what the Badgers do. They were asked about it several times this past week in preparation, talking about how taking on teams like Alabama and USC earlier in the season, which unfortunately those are their losses. But the broadcast kicks off across the Civic Media Network at 4:30. PM this Saturday on WLK, WRJN, WRCE, and which one other you're looking for them?
Here's what I have in my liners in the booth. The Wisconsin Badger 2024 football season kicks off on Friday, August 30th with broadcast. Zommers, get ready. Here we go. This one going out the window. Well, there you go.
Yeah. This is very impressive. You could throw that piece of paper very, very firmly, Mr.
Well,
Alba.
Well, I don't have any
shattered
talents.
A window with it.
Yeah.
But yeah, taking on Penn State, 4:30 p.m.
Broadcast. Here it is, right here. Here's a current one. 4:30, yes, of course you're right. 4:30 broadcast start time and kickoff, I believe, at 6:30 from Camp Randall. So there you go.
So it'll be a good one. What do you think? Penn State can
I? I have to stick with my preseason predictions. I'm not going to be a willy-nilly. And so I will say, unfortunately, I think the Badgers will get beat. But as you think on a three-game win streak, albeit against Rutgers, Northwestern, and Purdue, but I think they're looking better. I think that Braden Locke is locking in, to use the pun. And I think Wisconsin could win? Yes, I do. Do you know, I think that they will? No, I don't. Let's say
I think they could win. I'm excited. It's homecoming weekend, so I'm going to be optimistic. And I think the Badgers they have the upset this week.
Wow!
I think they're going to take them out. The college football has been very, very tumultuous, especially at that top of the top 10 of the AP's 25. It's been moving around a lot, and I think that there's no reason that the Badgers can't give some trouble to Penn State, and I think they're going to eke it out. It'll be less than a touchdown, but I think they get the upset.
You heard it here first. Luke Mathers predicting a Wisconsin Badger upset. Well, that would finally get him into the top 25.
I think so.
Yeah.
And we need Vanderbilt to lose, because, you know, they're fooling everybody by being in that top 25.
Well, Jacqueline, our HR director, I mean, she's a big LSU fan, so I think she said they play Vanderbilt this year, and now she's a little nervous because, you know, they knocked off Alabama.
That's true. So it'll be interesting to see how that shakes up. But I think the Badgers take care of business. I'll be more focused tonight on my Bucks, though, because it's a great weekend.
It is
for
a
Wisconsin
great weekend.
Sports.
Here's the problem, Luke Stern. I'll let you talk, but. I like that. Nothing wrong with the Bucks. I love Giannis, and I mean, I love the Bucks. But here's the problem with NBA basketball: it starts in one season, like autumnal seasons, and it finishes two seasons later. You have to go through fall.
That's the best part.
Winter, spring, and actually, it really ends in early summer. That's what also that grinds my gears.
Well,
it's too long.
Is baseball too long?
No, because
baseball does spring.
It barely
and summer
starts in spring.
And fall.
But it follows
spring
through.
Spring training starts in the middle of February. What are you talking about?
It lines up perfectly because in the spring you want hope, new growth. That's what baseball brings you. And then you celebrate and live in the summer. And then as things are dying off in the fall and you're getting ready to sleep, baseball goes to bed. It follows the calendar.
Yeah, but so it's the only sport that can have a long calendar? It's the only one?
It's an American tradition.
Okay. All right, Mr. Baseball, Mr. America.
And the Bucks are playing tonight.
I was just saying, the Bucks have their home opener against Chicago this evening, so that'll be a good game. I'm excited to see how all the role players come together around the big three. Chris Middleton still nursing some injuries, which is unfortunately too common for Middleton, but I'm excited. The Bucks are back.
The Bucks are back, baby.
And then you got Green Bay Packers taking on Jacksonville. It's going to be a full weekend of sports.
A lot of this is on Civic Media. Of course, Green Bay taking on Jacksonville. A 10 a.m. pregame show on Sunday across many of our stations in Richland Center, Park Falls, and Racine in Kenosha. The professional ones, unfortunately not able to stream, but you can hear it if you're in one of those beautiful areas of Wisconsin.
Break out the radio and listen to the Packers on the radio. It's going to be hopefully a pretty nice weekend too. So take care of some yard work. You got big plans for the weekend?
Preparing for this big week long trip across Wisconsin.
Yeah, you got to pack your bags.
I've got to do laundry. I've got to pack bags.
You're about to find out what makes Wisconsin great.
We know there's some people. Oh my gosh, look at that bus that just went by. There's another political bus.
Oh, interesting. That looks like an RV.
It is an RV.
I think it's an RV.
Yeah, but we're not going to. I said Hovey on the side of it.
I'm going to tell you.
I bet that he's not in there. I bet it's a faux Hovey bus.
Why would he be in there when he can be on the beach?
I don't think he's making any unscheduled trips to OC coming up. I think he learned his lesson on that one.
I'm getting ready for this trip. I'll be listening to these sporting events. Very interested to listen to the game tomorrow night, the Badger game against Penn State. What else have I got? That's pretty much because I got to be ready to go. And I got to be studying for election night as well because we get back and I got one day. And Pat Kreitel and I and our entire team anchoring our election night coverage on Tuesday.
Yeah. So have you already voted?
No, I'm going to go right after the show today.
Oh, see. Okay. So Todd's got his plan to vote. Mr. Zommers, you got your plan to vote?
Yep. So I am boarding for the Maggie Dawn show right after this. But then as soon as that's done, I'm going to walk on over to the library and vote there.
So, all right. You heard it here first. Yeah. We got plans to vote. You got to make sure that you out there have your plan to vote between now and November 5th. There's so many different ways to do it. You can return an absentee ballot if you've already requested one of those. You can go in person and early vote. In person absentee voting is underway wherever your municipality is. You got to find out where your in-person absentee voting location is. Go to myvote.wi.gov to check it out and make a plan. Or you can go on election day.
On election day proper. We can literally see the front doors to the Madison Central Library studio windows, and that's where Zomers and I are going to vote today. So, yeah. Yes.
And depending on what city you live, you might have a ton of options. In Madison here, I looked on myvote.wi.gov to see where I could vote early, and there were like 30 places.
Yeah. Right. There's a lot. And Madison used to have like 3 or 4 weeks of early in-person absentee voting too, until federal judge said that was too much early voting. Right. So that was sad when that happened. But now until election day, there's so many different ways. Make a plan. Be a voter.
One quick serious note here. Not serious too, but on WMDX here in Madison, a listener asks the question on the Civic Media app. I have a question. There is a referendum on the voting sheet. It reads like a GOP trap. Am I right? Thank you. Keep up the good work. We appreciate it. Whoever that listener is here in Madison. We went over this a couple of days ago. I know Maggie Dawn's talked about it. I know Jay Matinier. Others have talked about it. The short answer is yes, in my opinion. Luke, you can speak for yourself on it. I think it is an unneeded addition. I think it's actually nefarious on the Republican side. The legislature wrote this. It's essentially, here's the first fact. It's illegal to vote in the state of Wisconsin in any federal or state election if you are not a U.S. citizen, period.
Or if you're not a Wisconsin resident.
Period.
If you don't live here, if you don't live in the state of Wisconsin, you can't vote in the state of Wisconsin.
Period. That's already the current law. This particular amendment is written, yes, to make it confusing. It's essentially changing one word, and what it is doing is setting up for future legislatures, Congress, or perhaps a President Trump, a court case, where they could say, well, you know, what really constitutes a U.S. citizen, which Trump has said in Project 2025 has said that he is considering revoking naturalization. Those are people who have come here through a legal process, who have immigrated here, who have been naturalized and are full bird United States citizens. And Trump is entertaining revoking that, which then would open up the door possibly to not have people vote. So the quick answer, Luke, I think, is vote no on this referendum.
Yeah, and I have a very similar takeaway. The way that I describe it to folks that ask questions to me is a solution in search of a problem. I believe the Wisconsin Institute for Law and Liberty did an analysis of the 2020 election, and in that they found 20.
Right.
Not 2,000, not 20,000, not 200,000, 20.
Right.
Of like 3.5 million voters where they did not have citizenship and they attempted to vote in an election. Those votes are tossed out. It was inconsequential to the outcome of the 2020 election. And to say we are going to force every Wisconsin voter, again, in 2020, that's about 3.5 million people, we're going to force all of them to prove their citizenship, to register and to vote, is an added hurdle that will prevent more people from it will prevent voters from voting.
Legal voters.
It will hamper down legal voters from participating and exercising their right, their duty, in my opinion, to go to the polls and be voters.
Right.
And so I truly view it as a solution in search of a problem. And I will also be voting no on that constitutional ballot question.
Very good.
Current language, it says every voter, or every citizen can vote. That's a guarantee. This would change it to only citizens. That is an exclusion.
Right. Very well said. Luke Mathers, what's worse, hand-patted or pre-shaped hamburgers?
Hand-patted or pre-shaped burgers. I really like a good smash burger.
Yes.
So when you start make a nice ball of the ground beef, and then you put that on the grill, and then you press it down. So which one would that classify as then?
You'd say you'd be a hand-patted guy versus over a pre-shaped.
Pre-shaped. Yeah.
Pre-shaped, like the perfectly round ones that like come from a freezer. Well, I mean, I don't know that they're bad. And I was talking about the reason.
I would say the pre-shaped is worse then. Yeah, I think the hand patty is better.
I agree with you. We were talking about York Steakhouse, again, long before your time, at West Town Mall. And apparently there was one at East Town Mall. The now defunct, apparently there was one left in 2017 in Columbus, Ohio. York Steakhouse had great pre-shape, but other than that, I'm a hand-pattied type of guy.
There you go.
Boy, am I. Back after this on the Civic Media Radio Network, jump around. It's homecoming. Bucky Badger, the marching band on Wisconsin. Eat a rock on the Civic Media Radio Network.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
Welcome back to the Tunnel Ball Show on the Civic Media Radio Network, 9 before the hour of 2 o'clock at the top of the hour, ABC or CBS Sports News, depending upon which station you're listening to. Then a look at sports, or the very, very own sports reporter, Mr. Mike Clemens, check of weather, and then back into another edition of the great Maggie Dawn Show every afternoon from 2 until 4, Maggie Dawn, followed by Dom Selvia Show from 4 to 6, our friend Pete Schwabo with Nightlight from 6 until 8, and then it is Rick Smith Across America and Native Roots Radio, a full lineup right here at Civic Media. Be sure to tune in all afternoon and evening long. Right now, talking with our friend, the special Friday edition of Tuesday Tangents with Luke Mathers. Quickly, what's grinding your gears?
Oh, what's grinding my gears? I thought we were diving right into the poor game of the week. That's okay.
Did you have anything?
Do I have anything that's grinding?
UW alum not wearing red and white. That's what's grinding my gears.
That's fair. That's honest. I'm wearing it for homecoming tomorrow.
Are you going to the game?
I wish. Oh. No, I'm not going to the game. I will be watching the game, and we've got some plans to go probably to the Beloit Farmers Market. Done that one yet. All right. We're excited. We've heard really good things.
Beautiful day for a farmers market tomorrow, I think.
It's going to be the last one of the season. It should be a gorgeous day, so we're excited to try that out. And what's grinding my gears is just anybody. We are in the last 11 days.
Yeah.
If you're not just making a plan to be a voter and talking to as many people in your life and encouraging them to do the same, ignore the polls, ignore the freak out, the anything like that. Nobody knows anything. We are in unprecedented times.
Yeah.
The only thing that you can guarantee is you're getting yourself and as many people you know to the polls. And so it's just grinding my gears that there's so much back and forth. Gotta watch the horse race. Just ignore all that stuff. do the work, make a plan, be a voter, and that's my recommendation to avoid grinding your gears.
I hate quoting him, but to quote Aaron Rodgers, R-E-L-A-X, relax.
There you go.
And vote.
There you go.
Relax and vote. All right, time for another edition of Board Game of the Week.
Welcome back to another edition of Board Game of the Week. This time, it's not my board game.
A guest boarder.
A guest gamer.
Guest gamer. All right. Guest gamer Luke Mathers. What's your board game of the week?
I love this segment, by the way.
Yes.
Long time listener. First time guest boarder.
First time player.
First
time player. We played on Tuesday.
You were also a first time player.
Yeah, we got to play the presidential debate one. So that was fun.
Yes, the contender.
First time contender. But long time listener, first time co-hoster for board game of the week.
Sounds like many of my dates, first time player. Anyway, go ahead.
Oh, Jesus. Mr. Halba. TMI.
Go ahead.
But this one's called Chronology, and it was a fun one. My family, my little brother, like Mr. Zommer's, big advocate for board games, and so the whole family though just loves getting together around the table playing cards or board games. And so we were together 2 weekends ago now, and we were celebrating some family birthdays, and board game got broke out, and it is called Chronology, and it's a pretty exciting game.
I've heard of that. Yes, go ahead.
You've heard of it. Have you played it?
I think I might have played it. My nieces are like, Uncle Todd. Go ahead.
Okay. So Mr. Zommers has the rules and the breakdown and some of these things. But it's a fun game because you just have to try to put in order 10 different cue cards that have different events on them. But you have to put them in chronological order according to the date of like the year. And so it gets really close all of a sudden because you get asked these questions. There's 4 different categories. I can't remember all 4 categories off the top of my head, but there's 4 categories, and you have to try to put them. It's like history, sports, inventions, and I can't think of the 4th one.
Arts and entertainment.
Thank you, Mr. Zommers. And you have to kind of guess. And for some, it's really easy. It's like the founding of Rome, and you're like, oh, okay, that's really old. You're gonna put that at whatever BC.
Believe me, I was there.
See exactly. So maybe it was a little bit more difficult because you remember all these things, Todd. You got to try to put them in order then. But so there's some easy like that. But then there's somebody broke this home run record.
Right.
And you got to put it in between this window where you're like, I think this player was playing around that time, but you've got 3 other cards right around that same time. It's a fun game. So it was a good time. You may have played it?
I think I may have played it on a camping trip a long time ago. It's similar to like when you go to the Badger game or the Brewers games, and they have like, you know, this happened in what year, you know?
Yeah.
Paul Molitor got this, buddy, this, and you know, this song was out. And then you're right. Then I guess it was it 1981 or 1982 or 1984, something like that.
But you have to put 10 of these in order. And if you miss it, the person behind you, like to your left, gets the opportunity, if they know where it fits on their board, they can steal. And it's the first one to 10 in a row wins. And it was a fun game.
That's fantastic. Have you played it, Zommers?
Not yet, but I'd like to.
Whoa,
and it's not expensive.
How much is it?
So Chronology, 2 to 8 players, takes about 30 minutes, pretty easy to pick up, and it costs
$20.
Huh, so not bad at all. You've stumped the Zommers.
There we go.
A game that he hasn't played.
Not yet.
I haven't played everything. I've played a lot of things.
You played a lot. You're a board game expert. Much more than
aficionado. I think not just an expert, aficionado.
Right. There you go. Well, fantastic. Chronology is called?
Chronology,
there you go. Board game of the week. All right, gentlemen, we've gotten to that point in the program. We don't do this often, but we have a couple minutes to kill here. Craig Ferguson used to do this frequently at the end of his show. Luke, what have we learned today? What have we learned?
Communication's key.
Communication is key, Zommers.
I mean, that's always true.
All right. What have we learned? I would say we learned that democracy is still alive and well. And Reed Ribble says that it's alive and well as a Republican. Democrats are saying it. And we have to have faith in our voting and get out. And like Luke says, make a plan, be a voter. All right, Luke Mathers, Reed Ribble, Mr. Aaron Zommers, all of you for listening. We thank you all. Have a great weekend. We'll see you from the road, or we start in Madison on Monday. So be with us all next week for our road trip. Until then, whatever you're fighting for, whatever you believe in, keep banging your drum. Maggie Dawn is next.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.